Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about the distillation technology. So why I choose this topic? Because this is a heat transfer operation as well as the mass transfer operation. So many of us are knowing about the distillation technology, the basic principle, working mechanisms, the applications, and the various things related to this distillation technology. But still, I'm going to remind you for the various technologies which is available or the commercially available or going to commercialization in near future. So what are the technologies? What are the problems with the conventional distillation technology? How to tackle that problems in this at the commercial scales, in the laboratory scale or in the R&D scale? And then what are the solutions or the provisional solutions for this distillation technology? So I'm also going to share you some of the commercial examples from the industries, and then we will conclude our session. So basically, from this diagram or the picture, you can understand what exactly the distillation is. So we know the various products from the distillation column, that is the gases, that may be LPG, NG, etc. Then maybe in the form of liquid, that is petrol, diesel, various oils, or maybe in the form of semi-solids or solids like asphalt or waxes. So we know that when we are providing the crude oil as a feed in the distillation column, so at different temperatures and the mixture of vaporization and condensation technique at different plates or in the packings, we are having the different products or the side products or the multiple products. Sometimes we are going to tackle the binary mixture, sometimes we are tackling the three component mixtures, and sometimes we are tackling the multi component mixtures. So depending on the conditions, depending on the feed conditions, depending on the type of column, and depending on the requirement of our industry, we are going to select the type of column, the type of distillations, and various temperature, pressure, flow rate parameters, etc. But from this diagram, basically, everyone can understand that these are the main products from the distillations. Basically, there are different types of distillations like simple distillation, then flash distillation, then reactive distillations, then azeotropic distillation, steam distillation, etc. But I'm not going to give you the details of each and every one. I'm going to focus only on the plate column or the fractionating column, and in that, the commercial scale distillation processes and what are the advanced technologies are available at the lab scale, R&D scale, and at the commercial scale. So what is the future prospectus of the different advanced technologies as far as the distillation is concerned? So basically, it is a separation process of liquid-liquid component on the basis of the boiling points or on the basis of relative volatility. So we know that volatility means the component is having the volatility property. So volatility is there, and if there are more components, that is why the relative term is there. And on the basis of this relative volatility means one component is more volatile, second component is less volatile as compared to the first component, like that. And if the boiling point is the main property or the main criteria on which this distillation process can be carried out. So if the temperature difference is more, then we can easily separate out these components from these mixtures. So that is one of the or basic characteristics of this distillation process. As we are providing the thermal energy, because on the basis of boiling point, we are going to separate out these components. So if the thermal energy is provided, it means this is the heat transfer process. And on the basis of concentration difference, because when we are talking about the mass transfer operations, so the driving force is concentration difference. So in this case, in the distillation, the delta T, that is the driving force of heat transfer, and delta C, that is the driving force of the concentration difference, that is for the mass transfer operations. So distillation is the technology where heat transfer as well as mass transfer operation is carried out. It is a simultaneous vaporization and condensation techniques, because we are going to give the thermal energy to the mixtures, and the more volatile component is obviously initially vaporized from that mixture, and then that vapors are going to condense in the condenser, and then we can separate out this condensate or the vapor product as a distillate from the top of the column, or we can give some or the part of that liquid again to the column for increasing the purity or the concentration of that product. So we are going to provide the thermal energy. That is why we require some thermal energy provider requirement. Normally it is called as reboiler. So in the distillation operation, basically if you are talking about the industrial or the commercial scale distillation, then we have to use the reboiler, column and condenser, the major components for the distillation separation process, right? So basically when we are talking about the distillation as a word, so it is basically from the Latin word destillare. So that means dripping down, that is the condensation, because we already talked that in the distillation, we are condensing the vapors. So vapors are going to convert into the liquid. That is nothing but the condensation or dripping down technique. So in the Latin word, the destillare means dripping down. And that is why this distillation word comes from that Latin word. So mainly it is used in the petroleum and chemical industries. And presently, the conventional techniques consist of the vertical hollow column or the towers. So normally it is called as distillation column or a distillation tower. So which consists of different types of heat exchangers or the pump, storage vessels, support structures and different pipes assemblies. So from this basic diagram, you can understand this is the schematic of a batch distillation and the continuous distillation. Because sometimes in the small scale or the medium scale industries, we require a batch distillation process. And for the large scale industries, we require the continuous distillation process. So from the first diagram in the figure one, we can understand what exactly this distillation is. So this is the distillation column. And so this is distillation column, and this is the condenser, and third one is reboiler. So these are the major three components of this distillation technique. And if you go for the continuous process, the similar parts are there, but we have to provide the continuous feed. We have to use the continuous distillate and reflux, and then we have to continuously separate out this bottom product, right? So in this case, when we are talking about this distillation as a batch process, so we can understand we have to initially feed the feed in this column, that is indirectly in the reboiler. Then we are going to provide the steam, that is indirectly the thermal energy, to this feed or the mixture of components, that is the liquid-liquid mixture. And with the help of this thermal energy, this, when the components, mixtures, or the boiling point or the bubble point is achieved, then the more volatile components are going to separate out from this distillation column. And through these plates, or sometimes packings are used, through these packings, this vapor product is going to separate out, right? So after this, these vapors are going to convert into liquid, that is the condensation, with the help of this condenser. And this condensate is going to collect in the reflux drum. So if the required purity is achieved, then we can separate out this condensate as a distillate in the receivers. So if this is the first point, then it is called as first cut. And if the second cycle is there, then it is called as second cut. Likewise, if the required purity or the concentration is not achieved, then we have to send some part of this condensate liquid to the distillation column. And that part of the liquid from this condensate is called as reflux. So if the requirement is there, then we can provide the reflux into the distillation column. And due to this high concentrated liquid, which is contacted with the feed mixture, then we will definitely get the high concentrated liquid as a product. And if again we have to check whether the required concentration is achieved or not, and if it is the case, then obviously we can separate out this final product as a distillate. So that is the simple batch distillation process. And in the same way, the principle or the working is one and the same, but we have to continuously feed that feed. So we have to feed this multi-component mixture in this column. So that may be in the form of liquid, that may be in the form of mixture of liquid and vapor, or that may be in the form of vapors. So depending on the feed conditions, the separation technique is achieved. And again, this mixture of component is heated by this reboiler. And then if the vapors are created, these vapors are going to the condenser. And in the condenser, these vapors are going to convert into the liquid. And again, the same cycle is going to happen. But in this case, we are providing the feed on a continuous basis. We are continuously feeding the liquid condensate as a reflux to the top of the distillation column. And we are continuously separate out these bottom products or the distillate. And that is why it is called as continuous distillation column, right? So this is the basic batch distillation and continuous distillation. So generally we are using the plate column and the pack column as a distillation column or the equipment. And that is why we are using the different types of plates in the plate column. Normally, we are using the sieve plate or the wall plate or the bubble cap plates in the plate column. And if you are using these packings in the distillation column, so normally these bull saddles or pawl rings, cross ring, partition ring, cross partition rings, or interlock saddles, etc., are the different types of packings which can be used in the pack columns. So generally, in the commercial distillation techniques, we are using a plate column or the pack column. So depending on the requirement, depending on the conditions, normally the parameters like pressure drop, the concentration differences, the temperatures, the pressure parameters, the flow rates, then the properties like corrosive fluids or the viscous fluids or some other properties of that fluids, on the basis of that, we have to select whether we have to go for the plate column or whether we have to go for the pack column. So depending on the different parameters, we have to choose these plate or pack columns. Then after discussing the basics of the distillations, we know that there are main disadvantages of the distillation technology. And one of the main disadvantages from the industrial point of view is the main initial or the investment is very heavy. So the overall cost of the distillation technology is more as compared to the other things. And that is why we have to use the process intensification technology for solving these problems. So mainly, process intensification is a process design philosophy that improves the process flexibility, products, speed to market, and inherent safety with the added benefits of reduced environment footprint. So the main principles of this PI technology are the maximize the effectiveness of intra and intermolecular events, give each molecule the same process experience, then optimize the driving force at every scale and maximize the specific surface area to which these forces apply, and maximize the synergistic effects from the partial processes. So to overcome this initial or the overall cost of distillation technology, we can adopt this process intensification technology and their principles. So with the help of this PI technology, we can approach this PI technology for the distillation technology. So there are four domains through which we can approach this PI technology to the distillation technology. That is special, that is the structure, then thermodynamic energy, then function energy, or the time. So mainly when we are talking about the distillation technology, generally the industrial people talking about the energy requirement. So in the distillation technology, there is a huge requirement in the energy. So that may be a thermodynamic energy or the functional energy. And they're also talking about the design or the complex structure of this distillation technology. And what exactly the time requirement for the separation of this liquid-liquid mixture components. Again, nowadays, if you are talking about any type of chemical industry or the chemical process, then we have to focus on the safety aspects also. And with the help of this PI technology, with the help of these PI principles and through these domains like structure, energy, time requirement, we can achieve the inherent safety or the safety design in the distillation technology. But how to get these things and which things we have to focus before giving the different types of solutions? So main drawbacks of the distillation technology is the high capital cost. Then large equipments are used in the distillation technology. Then significant operating cost due to low energy efficiency, because the energy efficiency is quite low as compared to the other processes. And that is why the operating cost is also more. So for that purpose, in the distillation column, we must study some of the facts, like distillation accounts for over 40% of the energy used in the chemical process industry and over 95% of the energy used in the separation process. So the main problem is the use of costly high quality energy that is rejected at a low temperature in the condenser. So practically, the thermodynamic efficiency of the distillation is quite low, from 80% in air separation units to 12% in the Kourou units, and only 5% for ethylene and propylene production. So we can understand that from the energy requirement and the energy efficiency is very less. So we have to focus on the energy, and in some of the processes, the cycle for the distillation or the separation process is more. So we have to focus on the time also. And in some of the cases, some of the equipments and some of the structural supports or the type of packing, etc., our requirement is very huge. And that is why we have to also focus on the structure. So these are the different domains of this process intensification technologies from which we can focus on the problems, and then we can think about the solutions or the different technologies which can be adopted by the lab or R&D or by the industries. So what are the different solutions? So one of the major solution is we have to go for the different advanced distillation technologies. So that technology may be a green design, that may be a smart design. So if you go for the green design, it means we are focusing on the efficient use of materials, energy and water conservation, safe and healthy surroundings. So with the help of minimum water consumption, minimum energy consumptions, or efficient material utilizations, we can adopt the green design concept. And the second one is smart design concept. So we have to choose in a smarter way what exactly the material should be used, what are the different feedstocks available. We have to compare all the feedstocks, and then smartly we have to select that feedstock. Then we have to also select the different energy requirements. We must study the different energy requirements. Normally, the conventional energy is that is the electricity from the power plants. But nowadays, we are also having the options that energy generated from the solar energy, wind energy, or some other types of renewable energy types also. We can also adopt the different biobricate materials or the eco-friendly materials instead of coal. That is also one of the smart selection, and that is why these things are called as smart design concepts. So we have to think about the green design from the environment point of view. We have to think about the smart design from the economical point of view, from the energy point of view, and from the safety point of view also. So in the smart design concepts, there are three levels of approaches, that is construction materials and resources, then process design and configurations, and then internal design optimizations. So from the various parameters, we can have the different studies. From this diagram, you can understand there are different parameters like reflux ratio. So normally this reflux ratio is nothing but the external reflux ratio, that is called as L by D. So capital L is nothing but the liquid flow rate and capital D is nothing but the distillate. So this L by D is called as reflux ratio. And if you compare this reflux ratio with number of theoretical stages, because in the distillation column, if you study the commercial distillations column or the conventional technologies, which is already running in the different industries, then you can understand there are theoretical stages or the plate columns are mainly utilized in the industries. So if you are using the plate column, so obviously we have to calculate the number of plates or the number of theoretical stages. If you study the reflux with the number of theoretical stages, then there is a relation that if you increase the reflux ratio, then the number of theoretical stages are less, and vice versa. It means if the reflux ratio is more, the number of theoretical stages are less. So from this graph, you can understand this is the N minimum requirement, that is the number of theoretical stages are less here from this point, and here the reflux ratio is minimum. So this is the point where minimum theoretical stages and minimum reflux ratio is utilized. If you compare these different graphs or the curves, then you can understand that the theoretical stages are going to reduce if you increase the reflux ratio. So this negative graph clearly indicates that if you are going from left to right, that is on the x-axis, it means we are going to increase the reflux ratio. Obviously, on the y-axis, the number of theoretical stages is going to decrease. So this negative graph indicates that if you increase the reflux ratio, the number of theoretical stages requirement is very low. And in a similar way, if you also consider what exactly the effect on the commercial scale, so if the theoretical stages requirement is less, it means the plates requirement is less, it means the complex design, the cost of design is less as compared to the normal one. But vice versa case is that if you are going to increase the reflux ratio, obviously the operating cost is also going to increase. Because if the reflux ratio is increased, obviously the load on the boiler or the reboiler and load on the condenser is also going to increase. So we have to balance these things. That is the fixed cost as well as the operating cost. And that is why we can adopt the smart design concept. So if you observe this conventional design point and the smart design points. So this smart design point concept is here as compared to this conventional design. So this point from the graph indicates that the number of theoretical stages a little bit more as compared to the conventional technologies, but the reflux ratio is also less. So operating cost is going to decrease. So on the basis of our requirement, on the basis of our industrial requirement, we have to adopt the smart design concept instead of the conventional design concepts. So what are the different solutions for these different aspects or the problems what we have discussed, like the operating cost or the overall cost? That may be a fixed cost, that may be operating cost, or that may be a structure of distillation technology, that is the complex design or the different parts or the major equipments which are involved in the distillation technology, like reboiler, condenser, column, pumps, compressor, etc. So the different advanced technologies which are available, that some of the technologies may be on the lab scale, some of the on the pilot plant scale, some are available on the commercial scale also. But still some research is going on for the higher efficiency and less cost with the energy efficiency. So first technology is HPAD, that is called as heat pump assisted distillations. So it is generally knowing up to the various industrial experts from the engineering point of view, but I'm going to revise you the principles of these different HPAD techniques. In the HPAD techniques, there are various operations like vapor compressions, then mechanical vapor recompressions, then thermal vapor recompression, absorption heat pump, compression resorption heat pump, and thermoacoustic heat pump, and then heat integrated distillation column. So intentionally, I have put all these HPAD principles and HPAD techniques in a single slide so that you can easily understand the comparison of these different techniques which is available under this HPAD techniques. So in the vapor compression, that is the first one. So we can easily understand there is a distillation column, there is a condenser, there is a reboiler, and we are feeding this feed. Then the mixture is going to the reboiler and the thermal energy is going to provide to the reboiler, and then vaporization technique is started. And after the vaporizations, these vapors are collected into the condenser and these vapors are going to convert into the liquid droplet, that is the condensation technique. And this condenser is having the condensates. So these liquid droplets can be separated out as a distillate or can be sent to the top of the distillation column as a reflux. This is the basic distillation techniques. Now, vapor recompressions. And from this terminology, we can understand the vapors which are coming out from the distillation column can be compressed with the help of compressor. And that is why this technique is called as vapor compression technique. Right? So this is a classical heat pump design proven already at industrial scales. And it uses a specific fluid as heat transfer medium that runs between the heat source and sink through a pipeline. So compressor is installed in between to provide the required work input, while a flash valve closes the cycle. So this vapor compression is particularly beneficial when dealing with the corrosive or fouling compounds. So these vapors are going to compressed and we are going to increase the quality of these vapors, and this improved quality vapors are can be utilized as a heating media. So we can provide these compressed vapors as a heating media in the reboiler. So we can save the cost of this steam, which can be separately or specially fed to the reboiler from the boiler. So we are going to save this fresh steam costing, but we have to add the cost of compressor and the operating cost also. So we have to compare, we have to balance these things, and then we can adopt the vapor compression cycle also. So as in this case, the compressors are involved, so which are quite expensive and hard to maintain the equipment. So expensive from the initial costing as well as from the maintenance point of view also. We have to balance all these things. The second one is MVR, that is mechanical vapor recompression technique. So in this case, when we are having the binary component mixture, and if the binary components are having the close boiling points, then we have to adopt this MVR as compared to the VC technique. Because in this case, we are going to use the compressor, but in this case, if you observe, there is no condenser. So we are not having the condenser. It means the initial investment and the operating cost of the condenser is decreased in the MVR case. So the heat pump is performed the function of the condenser, right? So in this case, the heat pump is going to perform the function of the condenser. That is why we can skip the condenser in the MVR techniques. So MVR features slightly higher efficiency and lower investment cost as compared to the vapor compression systems. But MVR does not tackle directly the main drawback of the VC, that is nothing but the compressor. Because in the VC technique, we are also using this compressor, and in the MVR also we are using the compressor. As the compressor is there, obviously the initial investment as well as the maintenance cost is increased as compared to the basic technology of the distillation column, right? So there is another technology, that is TVR, that is thermal vapor recompression. So from the VC and MVR, we can easily compare that this compressor is replaced by the steam ejector now. So here the main difference as compared to VC or MVR is the steam ejector is going to use instead of compressor. So what are the benefits by using this steam jet ejector? So this steam jet ejector is having the robust design and is also going to reduce the capital and maintenance expenditure, because in the compressor it is having the higher investment initially as well as the maintenance cost is more as compared to the steam jet ejector. So this is the one of the main benefit as compared to the VC and MVR in the PVC. So this relatively steam ejector has a low efficiency in converting the mechanical energy. So that is one of the main drawback in the steam jet ejector, that they are having the low efficiency in converting the mechanical energy. But TVR are mostly used for the system producing water as a top product. So if there is a requirement that we have to produce the water as a top product, then we can adopt this thermal vapor recompression technique. Otherwise, we have to select the other technologies if the top product is not the water. So an alternative to MVR and TVR, there may be a self-heat recompression technology, but this technology, that is self-heat recompression technology, adding two compressors, which again increases the cost. So with reference to the cost, this TVR is okay as compared to the VC, MVR and the heat recompression technology. Then there is another technique that is called as AHP. So that is absorption heat pump. So this considers thermochemical conversion to enhance operational efficiency. So in this case, absorption pairs are used as heat transfer fluids. For example, the ammonia and water, that is the pair. So absorption pair are used in this technology, or sometimes we are using lithium bromide and water. So this AHP is known as cycle, because we are using the absorption cycles, and that is why it is also known as cycle, and it is widely applied in the refrigeration systems. So when the industrial requirement is refrigeration, so we can adopt the AHP as compared to the previous techniques. So AHP is suitable for the distillation or the multi-stage evaporation process, and the key unit of AHP is the steam driven desorber. So in this case, desorber is also used. So here absorption is also used, desorber is also used, and we are using the absorption pairs, which increases the efficiency of the separation as compared to the previous techniques. So depending on the requirement, we can adopt this AHP. But the main advantage of these technologies, we are going to use the 5 heat exchangers, which gives AHP a very pricey installation cost and therefore long payback period. So initial investment is very high. So if it is affordable for that industry and if it is used for the refrigeration purpose, then only we can adopt the AHP. Otherwise, we can check the other technology. The next one is CRHP, that is compression resorption heat pump, CRHP. So in this case, it is also called as the hybrid heat pump, because in this case, we are using the compressor and resorption also. That is why it is called as compression resorption heat pump. So basically, if you compare this diagram and this diagram, it is near about same, but it is represented by this dotted line, and that is why the principal working mechanism is the different one. So this hybrid heat pump is a recent approach to take the advantage of thermochemical sorption process. So it is having a high COP, that is coefficient of performance, and due to this high COP, due to the absorption pairs or the working fluids, which we have mentioned in the HP also, this CRHP enhances the overall efficiency. So if you want the overall efficiency at higher level, then we can prefer the CRHP instead of the AHP. And it is basically again used or the suitable for the refrigeration systems. And generally, it is having the advantage that they can use the environmentally friendly refrigerant such as water, ammonia, and CO2. So eco-friendly refrigerant can be utilized in this case, and due to which the energy performance gains of more than 20% as compared to VC. So as compared to VC, the energy efficiency is more. So 20% energy efficiency is more in the CRHP as compared to the VC. Then the next technology is THP, that is thermoacoustic heat pump. So in this case, it is a thermoacoustic device. So in the diagram, it is mentioned as a driver. So this device that uses high amplitude sound waves to pump heat from one place to another. So this driver is nothing but the device which produces a sound waves or generate a sound wave to give the heat. So this device consists of a heat exchanger, a resonator, and a regenerator or stack. So this is the device which depends on the type of engine, a driver or a loudspeaker which generate the sound waves, and we have to also think about the noise level. So as per as the Maharashtra factory rule 1963 in the Maharashtra state, we have to control the noise level below 85 decibels. So this driver is going to generate the sound, and they are going to act as a heat exchanger, and this heat is going to provide in the distillation column. So up to 100 degrees Celsius temperature, so this technique is suitable. So there are different applications of these technologies also there. So we have to check first before checking the applications, the comparison of this technology with HIDIX, that is heat integrated distillation column. So in this heat integrated distillation column, if you compare all these techniques, the principal mechanism is different one. So you can understand from this diagram that here is a rectifier, here is a stripper, and the heat is transferring from the rectifier to the stripper. So in the conventional distillation column, we know that the top of the portion or the section above the feed is called as rectifying column, and below that feed, the lower portion is called as stripping section. But in this heat integrated distillation column, the rectifier is different one, the stripper is different one, and rectifier is going to transfer the heat to the stripper, and then the vapors which are created from the stripper are going to compressed and increase the quality of that vapors, and which can be again utilized as a heating media into the rectifier. So that is the principal mechanism of this heat integrated distillation column. So we can have the look of all these HPAD, that is heat pump assisted distillations techniques. So each technique is having some advantages, some disadvantages, and depending on the requirement, depending on the conditions, we can go for the different applications. So before selecting the particular distillation technique from this HPAD, we must check the applications. So these are the different applications. So if the butane isobutane separation is there in your industry, then we must go for the AHP. For the water acetic acid, it is also suitable. For the steam production or the benzene toluene, we must go for the CHRP. For the N-pentane, cyclopentane, cyclohexane, or M-pentane, propane, propylene, methanol water, benzene toluene systems, or the acetic acid dehydration systems, we must go for the heat integration systems. For the butane separation or the propane propylene benzene toluene separation, isobutane separation from the butane, or the propane propylene acetic acid dehydration systems, we can adopt the MVR systems. And for the methanol water systems, for the various temperatures, for various COP, for the various efficiency, we can adopt THP or MVR or the VC. So depending on the temperature differences, temperature conditions, coefficient of performance, and energy efficiency conditions, we can adopt the different technology from this HPAD technology. So this is one of the advanced technology that we have discussed. And the second advanced technology is heat integrated distillation column. So what is that? We already discussed in brief what exactly the heat integrated distillation technology is. So here it is a rectifier, here it is a stripper, and we are going to provide the heat from the rectifier to the stripper, and this vapors which are generated from the stripper are compressed by this compressor, and improved quality of this vapor acts as a thermal media to the rectifier again, and this cycle is continuous. So when we are feeding this liquid-liquid component mixture as a feed to the stripper, then with the help of this simultaneous vaporization and condensation technique, with the help of boiling point and with the help of relative volatility on the basis of vapor differences, we can separate out the distillate as a top product from the rectifier and the less volatile components from the bottom product. So in a similar way, you can have the look for the different techniques in the heat integrated distillation column. So in this case also, you can observe now this stripper is having the different size and at the top of the column, that is as compared to the rectifier. Now in this case, this is at the bottom level. So if you compare this, this is of the top of the column as compared to the rectifier column, and now it is at the bottom. The principal mechanism is one and the same. In a similar way, in the third diagram, if you observe, the rectifier is having the smaller size and the stripper is having the larger size. And in the fourth diagram, if you observe again, the rectifier is having smaller size, but it is at the top level. Now it is, in this case, it is at the bottom level. So there are various alternative configurations of this heat integrated distillation column. So depending on the different configurations, depending on the different applications, we have to choose wisely which heat integrated distillation column is suitable, affordable, cost effective, and energy effective from the industrial point of view. So the most radical approach of heat pump design, making use of internal heat integration, is this technique, that is heat integrated distillation column technique. So this is the energy efficient technology and having the good hardware performance also. And here both the heat and mass transfer takes place in with good efficiency, and that is why in many of the cases, this heat integrated distillation column is going to adopted by the various industries. So highest energy saving possible possibility can be here in these techniques. Capital investments cost are higher as compared to the conventional distillation column, but the savings are also at higher level. So wherever if the cost, that is the initial cost, is affordable by that industry, then obviously they are going to adopt this technology. So in the commercial cases, some of the companies have already adopted this technology. So this process can be operated very smoothly with no control difficulties. There are some examples of this technique also, that is the flexibility to change in the operating conditions, then influence of an impurity or a third component or the process dynamic and operations. These are the drawbacks of the conventional systems which can be overruled, that these issues of these conventional technologies overruled in the heat integrated distillation column technology. So if you observe the compression ratio also, or the heat transfer coefficient and the area, then also from the basic heat transfer flux calculation, that is Q equal to UA delta T. So in this case, the overall heat transfer coefficient is higher, the area of heat transfer is also higher. So obviously heat transfer flux is more, and that is why the efficiency is also more. The performance of this technology is very high as compared to the previous technology. So there may be a multi-tube, multi-shell plate type, or even structure packing, heat integrated distillation column can be utilized. So it is basically suitable for the binary mixture. It can also consider for the multi-component mixture also, right? So these are the different configurations for this heat integrated distillation column technology. So now from the 1977, you can understand, up to 2021. So from the parallel columns up to the shell and tube heat exchangers. And nowadays, these shell and tube heat exchangers are also having different or various configurations in the shell and tube heat exchanger. So in this case also, from this diagram, you can understand the various rectifying or stripping sections for this heat integrated distillation column. So a variety of design aspects, like in this case, you can understand inner part is rectifying, outer is stripping part. In the rectifying part, in the previous case, the downcomer and heat panel is utilized. And in this case, second one, the downcomer is outside, that is in the stripping section, and the heat panel is also outside, that is in the stripping sections. So various designs are available with reference to the complexity of the design and the affordability of that industry. We can adopt the various distillation configurations in the heat integrated distillation column systems. The next technology is membrane distillation configurations. So we are knowing about this membrane separation technique, or the membrane separation techniques, especially which is utilized for the water filtration, or waste water to normal water, or the effluent to the normal water. But in the distillation also, we can use the membrane. And in this case, this is called as membrane distillation, as we are using the membrane in the distillation or the separation of this liquid-liquid component mixture. That is why it is called as membrane distillations. So distillation is basically, we know that on the basis of relative volatility and boiling point, etc. But now in this case, we are also using the principle of reverse osmosis. So the driving force is the difference in vapor pressure across the hydrophobic membranes. So this is the membrane, which is indicated by the red dotted line. This is the hydrophobic membrane rather than the other membrane types, and it is specially can be utilized in the petrochemical industries also. So membrane distillation is specially useful for the application involving the bulk water removal. So if your need is bulk water removal, then we can go for the membrane distillation, especially when we are talking about the seawater and brackish water desalination processes, or the process water treatment, or the water purification systems. So in these systems, we have to separate out the water component, the main as a main product. Then we can adopt this membrane distillation technology. So similar hybrid separation methods based on the membrane technology, like per-evaporation or the separation of mixtures of liquid and partial vaporizations through the non-porous membranes, or the vapor permeations are also available. But membrane distillation is suitable as compared to these other conventional techniques. So the driving force of membrane distillation is the transmembrane vapor pressure difference. On the basis of this vapor pressure difference, obviously indirectly, that is temperature difference. So again, here the temperature difference is also involved, vapor pressure is also involved, and on the basis of vapor pressure, with the help of this reverse osmosis principle, we can separate out the bulk water from the fluid or the liquid-liquid component mixture. So it is a cost-effective separation techniques. And sometimes when we are talking about the seawater or brackish water or the ocean water, then we can adopt the energy as a solar energy or geothermal energy also. It means if you are using the renewable energy source instead of the steam from the boiler room, then we can decrease the overall cost of this membrane distillation technique also, right? So there are different techniques in this membrane distillation, like DCMD, AGMD, SGMD, and VMD. So this membrane distillation first type is direct contact. So from this diagram, you can understand this feed is going to insert into the membrane part and feed out it's there. Then here permeate in and permeate out. And in this feed and permeate, there is a membrane. So evaporation takes place because the temperature is there, hot solution, and that feed is nothing but the hot solution. So this hot solution is in direct contact with the hot membrane. That is why it is called as direct contact membrane distillation techniques. So vapor is transported to the permeate side due to vapor pressure difference, and membrane is hydrophobic nature. So we know that hydrophobic, hydro means water and phobic means heating. So this membrane is having the characteristic that is the hydrophobic nature. So water is not going to having the affinity towards that membrane. So it is going to heat, or it is going to repel that water molecules from that membrane. And obviously the efficiency is going to increase because we are going to remove that water or separate out that water from that membrane itself. So this hydrophobic membrane is utilized intentionally to increase the efficiency of this membrane distillation technique. So it is a simplest and most studied configuration, and heat lost by the conduction is one of the main issue in this case, because heat losses are there through the conduction heating media, and water is the major permeate component in this distillation techniques. So sometimes we are going to use the flat sheets membrane, sometimes we have to use spiral wound, sometimes we have to use capillaries or even hollow fibers membranes. So there are a variety of membranes available, and depending on the requirement, we have to choose the particular or a specific type of membrane in this DCMD techniques. Then the second one is AGMD, that is air gap membrane distillation column or the techniques. So we have added the air gap in this membrane and this distillation column. So in the previous case, there are only two parts, that is feed and permeate, and the partition is nothing but the membrane. Now in this case, we are adding the air gap. That is why it is called as air gap membrane distillation techniques. So why we are going to add this air gap? Because in the previous case, we have already discussed that the heat losses due to the conduction is the main issue or the drawback. Now in this case, we are providing the air gap as air is acts as a insulator. So we are going to decrease the heat losses with the help of this air gap. So the main intention is to decrease the heat losses, and that is why we have added this air gap in the distillation technique. So other things are near about same. The principal mechanism or the working mechanisms are one and the same. Then the third technique is SGMD, that is sweeping gas membrane distillation. So in this, air stripping is going there. So in the previous techniques, there is no condenser. Now in this case, we have added the condenser. So why this condenser is added? So whatever the vapors coming out from this membrane distillation column are collected to the condenser, and these gases or the vapors are going to condense it in this condenser, and this output is nothing but the permeate. So that is the difference. So we are going to sweep these gases or the vapors from the distillation column, and that is why this technique is called as sweeping gas membrane distillations. So if our requirement is the condensates of that gases or the vapors, then we have to utilize this sweeping gas membrane distillation technique. Then it is useful for the removing volatile components also from the aqueous solutions. But the main drawback of this technique is that a small volume of permeate diffuses in large sweep gas volume. So this requires a large condenser. So the main condenser requirement and the operating cost of this condenser is the main drawback of this SGMD technique. The next one is VMD, that is vacuum membrane distillation column. So as compared to SGMD, the other things are similar, but we are using the vacuum technology, and that is why it is called as VMD. So similar things are going to happen, but we are using the vacuum. So negative pressure, and that is why these vapors or gases are sucked by that condenser, and these gases or vapors are going to condensed in the condenser, and we got the permeate. So depending on our requirement, we can go for the different membrane distillation configurations techniques. Then the next technique is high G distillation using RPB, that is rotating pack bed technique. So high G distillation using RPB, that is one of the advanced technology in this distillation technology. So what exactly this distillation technology, that is high G and RPB? So from this diagram, you can easily understand here we are using the rotating pack bed. So we know general pack bed technique, but now in this case, this pack bed is there, but we are rotating this pack bed. So from this sign or symbol, you can understand this is going to rotate. So we are rotating this total pack bed, and that is why it is called as rotating pack bed technology. So this is a high G distillation RPB technology, where we are providing the liquid component mixture at the center of this column. Then we are using this liquid distributor here at the center of this rotating pack bed equipment. And from this distributor, this liquid is going to distribute throughout the bed. So this blue color line indicates the liquid inlet, and this liquid is going to distribute through the pack bed also. So these blue color lines are distributed, so that is away from the center with the help of centrifugal force, and that is the main thing in this RBC high G distillation techniques. So we are using the centrifugal force instead of the gravitational force. The gravitational force is utilized in the conventional distillation technology, but in this case, we are using the centrifugal force. So with the help of centrifugal force, this liquid is going to distribute through this pack bed away from the centers, and then this liquid is going with the help of gravitational force again and through the nozzle as a liquid outlet. And vice versa case, we are providing the vapor inlet from this nozzle and as a tangential inlet, and these vapors are going through this packed bed again, which is indicated by this red color or red arrows. And this is the counter current fashion, heat transfer as well as mass transfer. So these vapors, that is vapors are going towards the center, and these liquids are going away from the center. So this is the counter current fashion heat exchanger as well as the mass transfer equipment. So this is the rotatory packed bed distillation technique. So that is why it is called as high G distillation column with the RPB. So we are replacing the gravitational field by the centrifugal field. So RPB concept in a high gravity field technology are using, and we are normally using HTP concepts, that is height equivalent to theoretical plates values as low as 1 to 2 centimeters only. So HTP is very low and 3 to 6 times higher throughput, and an equipment volume reduction is also there in this case, and that is why we can utilize this technique as compared to the conventional one. So we can easily understand what exactly the working mechanism in this high G distillation column with the RPB, and with the help of this type of rotating beds, we can also change the different types of rotating beds also depending on the requirement. So generally in the industrial scales, we can utilize waveform disc or helical rotating bed or the spiral beds. Sometimes we can use multi-stage spraying rotating bed or rotating pack bed with the blade packing or rotating zigzag bed or rotating spit packing bed, etc. So there are variety of configurations available for the rotating pack bed assembly also. And on the basis of that, depending on the requirement, depending on the speed, depending on the efficiency, we have to choose the different packings assembly or the configurations. So it is having a very high volumetric mass transfer coefficient, and the size of equipment is reduced due to this high mass transfer coefficients. So gas flow velocity can be dramatically increased. The rotor is practically self-clean rotors and having the large driving force, and very viscous Newtonian fluids can also be handled in this high G distillation column with RPB. So that is why we, as compared to the conventional technologies, if you need the high mass transfer coefficient or the high gas velocities or self-cleaning rotating devices or the large driving forces, or if you want to handle the very viscous fluids in the distillation technique, then the high G distillation using RPB is the best choice for the separation techniques. So this is another configurations in which you can understand there are different equipments for the rectification purpose and for the stripping purpose. Other things are remain same, that is the reboiler, condensers, feeding mechanism, reflux mechanism, and the separation of distillate and bottom products. So this is the comparison what we have discussed with the conventional technology and with the high G distillation technology. The next choice is cyclic distillations. So from this diagram you can understand, if there is a cycle, then only we can understand the distillation is a cyclic distillation. So what is that cycle? So sometimes we are providing the vapors and we are blocking the liquid. So in this case, if you observe this first diagram of this cyclic distillation, where the distillation column, then number of plates or the type of plates, etc., then feeding, then condensate, reboiling mechanism, all these things are same. But in this case, we are providing the vapors, means we are switching on this wall for these vapors, but we are switching off or closing these walls for the liquid. So we are not going to provide this reflux, we are not going to provide this feed. So vertical rectangle indicates that these walls are closed, and this horizontal green symbol indicates that the valves are open. It means in this first diagram, we are providing the vapors only. We are closing this liquid from the reflux as well as from the feed, and then these vapors are going to flow. But in the distillation column, at these plates, the liquid droplets or the liquid holdup is already there. So through these liquid holdups, these vapors molecules are providing from bottom to top, and obviously these vapors are going to contact with these liquid droplets, and mass transfer takes place as well as the heat transfer takes place. So in this case, we are providing the vapors only through the liquid holdups. In the second diagram, if you observe, the feed is going to provide, it means we are providing the liquid or the mixture of liquid and vapors. In this case, if you observe this symbol, we are providing the reflux also in the condensate forms, that is in the liquid forms. But in this case, we are closing this valve, that is, we are not going to provide the vapor, right? So in the first case, we have provided the vapors only and not the liquid. Now in the second case, we are providing the liquid droplets, but not the vapors, right? So again, these liquid droplets are going or flowing from top to bottom with the help of gravitational force. So if you observe these blue dotted lines in this case, so that is liquid droplets are flowing from top to bottom. And again, these liquid droplets are contacted with this liquid holdups, and mass transfer and heat transfer takes place. In the third column, if you observe, the feed wall is also closed, liquid wall is also closed, and the vapor wall is open. It means this diagram is near about first diagram or similar diagram, right? But the conditions of temperature, pressure, flow rate, etc., or the vapor differences, vapor pressures are different one. But we have provided the vapor again, and we are closing the walls of liquid. It means this is the cycle. In the first case and in the third case, the similar things are happening. In the second case, the vice versa thing is happen. And again, the fourth diagram is again the second diagram. So this is nothing but the cycle. So cycle of providing the vapors and providing the liquid. That is why this distillation is called as cyclic distillations. So sometimes we are providing vapors, sometimes we are providing the liquid. That is nothing but the cyclic distillations. So it can be achieved by the controlled cycling, stepwise periodic operation, a combination of these two, or by stage switching also. So in the first case, second case, third case, we have already discussed what exactly the working mechanism is. So sometimes we can also adopt the vacuum distillation in the conventional techniques. But in this case, in the cyclic distillation, vacuum distillation is difficult task. So if the vacuum distillation is requirement, then we have to avoid this cyclic distillation as a separation techniques. But other potential applications for this cyclic distillation is biofuels, that is bioethanol, biodiesel, biobutanol, or organic synthesis, specialty chemicals, gas processing, petrochemicals, etc. Because there are various benefits in this cyclic distillations, like hydrate efficiencies, that is what we know, that is Murphy efficiency, that is plate efficiency. So near about 140 to 300% membrane, Murphy efficiency can be achieved in this cyclic distillation. Then we can reduce the energy requirement, and we can have the higher throughput with having the maximum capacity and maximum efficiency. We can also increase the quality of the products due to the high separation efficiency, and we are having the small pressure drops on the trays. So there are various benefits in the cyclic distillation as compared to the other distillation types. The next technique is dividing wall column, that is generally called as DWC. So what exactly this concept is? So the separation of the multi-component mixture requires a typically direct or indirect sequence of at least two distillation column. So normally we are using two distillation column. So in this case, we can understand the first column and this is second column. A more energetically favorable alternative configuration that avoids the remixing of internal steam is the first case. That first case is called as Petluke configuration. So this Petluke configuration is having the main advantage or the benefit or the plus point is that they are going to avoid the remixing of the internal streams, because in this column, vaporization, condensation, liquid droplets, then condensate, etc. So remixing and re-vaporization, recondensations are already happen in these columns. So to avoid that, we can utilize this Petluke configurations, right? And from this diagram, you can understand we are going to provide this feed. Then whatever the vapors are produced can be sent to the second column, and whatever the product is there, that can be separate out as a distillate. Some side streams can be separate out as a B point, and whatever the bottom products are there, we can send it out to the first column again, or we can separate out as a bottom product from as a C. So depending on the requirement, depending on the purity, depending on our quality of the streams, we can have the flexibility in the different streams in this Petluke configurations. And there is another technique that is called as DWC, dividing wall column. So from the picture itself, you can understand this distillation column itself divided. So this is divided with the help of wall. So this dividing wall is there, and that is why this distillation technique is called as dividing wall column distillation technique, right? So what is the purpose of this dividing column? So we have to separate out, we have to divide this feed from this condensate and from these vapors. So we have to avoid the remixing of the internal streams, and that is why we can adopt, that is the Petluke configuration, or we can adopt the DWC distillation techniques. So in this diagram, you can understand here it is called as pre-fractionation section. So it is nothing but the pre-fractionator. So before the distillation column or the main area of the distillation column, here itself the fractionation is going to happen. And that is why it is called as pre-fractionation section. So whatever the vapors are condensate in this condenser, and whatever the reflux is going to back to the distillation column, so that liquid droplets is again going to divide. That is split up into the two sections or the two streams. One stream is going in the pre-fractionating section, and second is going to the core section of this distillation column. In a similar way, whatever the vapors generated with the help of these reboilers are again split up into the two streams. That one stream is going to the pre-fractionation unit, and second one is to the core distillation column. So vapors are feeding to the pre-fractionation section. Liquid droplet, that is reflux, is also going to feed into this pre-fractionating unit, and feed is also going to feed into the pre-fractionating unit. So this portion itself acts as a distillation column or fractionator, and which is divided by this dividing column. So this is the simple principle, working principle of this dividing wall column distillation technique. So it gives the high purity side product. So in this case, this B product is a side product. So this DWC technique is going to provide the high purity side product, and that is why wherever the industrial applications are there, that apart from the top product, if you want to have the side products and that is high purity, then we can adopt this DWC distillation technique. So commercially, it is already adopted by the BASF companies and Mons companies, etc. And due to the high thermodynamic efficiency and due to the reduced remixing effect, 25 to 40% lower energy requirements and the high purity of all the product streams, reduce maintenance cost, small footprint up to the 30%, lower investment. These are the different benefits of this DWC. That is why some of the large scale industries have already adopted this DWC techniques. But what are the limitations of this DWC techniques? Operation at single pressure, larger size, that is the diameter and height, it should be larger because we have to insert that dividing wall, we have to insert that pre-fractionating unit, and that is why the diameter requirement is more. The height is height requirement is also more, and that is the main drawback of this DWC column. So initial investment is high, that is the main issue in this DWC. So more expensive utilities are utilized, but if your company is going to afford that, then we can adopt this DWC technique, right? So we can have some simulations before adopting this DWC. So we can utilize that Aspen Plus, ChemCAD, HiSys or ProSy, and with the help of these simulation softwares, we can have the calculations and the deciding factors with the whether to go for the DWC techniques or not. So from the commercial scale, there are variety of configurations are available in this DWC techniques. So this is the first configuration that is called as bottom split column. So this bottom is going to split into two reboilers, and this is the splitting wall. So this bottom portion is splitted with the help of this dividing wall, and there are two reboilers are involved. So this is called as bottom split column. In a similar way, at the top of the portion in the distillation column, this splitted wall or dividing wall is inserted, and this condenser's requirement is two now. So this is called as top split column assembly. Third one, it is called as Kaibel column. So in this case, the dividing wall is at the center, and we can have the side streams or the side products. Then we can have the multi-partition DWC, means we are having more than one dividing wall. So in this case, there are three dividing walls, and that is why it is called as multi-partition DWC distillation assembly. In a similar way, we can have this multi-partition DWC and different side streams, top streams from this distillation column. So this is called as Sargent and Agrawal arrangements. So in the last one, here it is side products as a B, here it is bottom side products as C, and it is top the product that is A as a distillate, and top bottom product as a D. So these are the various configurations. So depending on the requirement, depending on the efficiency, and depending on the parameters and the affordability of that company, we can adopt this DWC. So most of the industrial DWC units are exploited by the BASF. So BASF is mainly utilized this DWC techniques. Near about 70 plus units are already installed in the BASF company and some other companies. The other companies like Bayer, AG or Dow Chemical Corporation or Lonza, LG Chemical Limited, etc. are already utilized this DWC configurations. So near about 125 plus applications are there with the help of this DWC. So whenever the low fractions of light and heavy boiling components are there, then obviously we should prefer this DWC techniques. So there are again various configurations with this DWC techniques are also adopted by the various industries. So separation of broad spectrum chemicals like hydrocarbons, alcohols, aldehydes, ketones, acetals, amines and others, then we can go for the DWC. But depending on the requirement, we can adopt the RDWC or ADWC or EDWC. What is that? So R indicates the reactive distillation. A indicates the azeotropic distillation and E indicates the extractive distillations. It means we are using the reactive distillation principle, but in DWC technique. We are using the azeotropic distillation principle, but in DWC technique, and we are using this extractive distillation principle in the DWC technique. So depending on our requirement, we can go for this RDWC or ADWC or EDWC techniques. So these are the variety of applications of these dividing wall columns, especially in the ternary separations like benzene, toluene, xylene fractionations, or the separation of hydrocarbons from the Fischer top synthesis, etc. That may be utilized for the undisclosed systems like multi-component separations, then retrofit of conventional columns to the DWC or the reactive DWC or azeotropic or extractive. So variety of applications are there. So depending on our requirement, we can choose the different configurations under this DWC. So this is the another advanced technology that is called as reactive distillations, which is more efficient and require less energy. So from this graph, that is temperature versus pressure, you can understand this is the operating window separation. This is the operating window reactions. So wherever the separation processes or separation principle, that the distillation is involved, as well as the reaction is also involved, then it is called as reactive distillations. So whatever the equipments we have to utilize, that should be sustained and compatible with the reactions as well as with the separation. So this clearly indicates that this reactive distillation involves the reaction as well as the distillation principles at a particular temperature and pressure range. So this is the overlapping windows of operating conditions and reaction types, because we know that there are variety of reactions, and that is why with the help of reaction types, we have to choose or we have to select appropriate RD technology. For example, this is the area. So if your reaction is A gives B like that, then near about 7.6% RD technology can be utilized. In a similar way, you can understand A plus B gives C, or A gives B plus C, or A plus B gives C plus D, or two-stage reaction and three-stage reactions are already indicated by the different percentage type. So this reaction technology or reaction distillation can be utilized depending on the type of reaction which is involved in that process. So this is the reactive distillation column, or reactive DWC, or reactive distillation with pre-reactor and side reactors. So various configurations are available in the reactive distillation column. So this is the simple distillation column with the condenser and reboiler, and all the working principles are near about same. But in this case, the reaction is going to happen. And for this reaction, we can utilize the catalyst, and with the help of this catalyst, we can enhance the performance of these reactions. And whatever the products are formed, this product can be separated out as a distillate, and sometimes the product can be separated out as the bottom product. It means with the help of these reactions, we are going to increase the separation efficiency of this distillation column. So that is the basic mechanism of this reactive distillation column. In this case, second column, we are using this DWC phenomena or the principle in the reactive distillation column. So dividing wall we already discussed, and the similar things are there, but in this case, reaction is also going to happen, and this reaction is going to help you for increasing the separation efficiency. In the third case, we are using the pre-reactor. This EQ indicates the pre-reactor. It means the reaction is also going to happen in the initial stage, and then this feed is going to fade into the core or main distillation column. And again, side by side, side reactors are also available. So there are three reactors, pre-reactors, side reactors, and the main reactor also. So in the distillation column also, the reaction is going to happen in the pre-reactor also and in the side reactor also. It means all this third component or the third diagram is going to enhance the separation efficiency of the distillation process. So this is all about the reactive distillation column. So sometimes whenever we have to go for the alkylation process, amination process, carbonation process, condensation process, esterification, etherification, or hydration, hydrogenation, hydrolysis, isomerization, nitration. And if you want to separate out the components, then we can adopt the reactive distillations and with the appropriate catalyst. So these are the variety of advanced distillation technology or the separation technology what we have discussed. I'm going to give you the brief idea regarding the case studies. So this is the polyester synthesis. So in this diagram you can understand we are going to produce the polyester from the MAD and PG. MAD means the maleic anhydride and the PG means propylene glycol. So this is the commercial applications to prepare the polyester with the help of this raw material. But the main thing is we are utilizing the RDC now. So reactive distillation can be utilized for preparing this polyester with the same raw material. We can also adopt this technology with the help of this pre-reactor technique. But the main distillation technique is reactive distillation column. The second is bioethanol dehydration. So in this technique, as compared to the conventional technique, we can utilize the extractive distillation in this process. So we have to produce the bioethanol. So if you observe, this is the feed that is 5 to 12%, then it is going to convert to 94%. And then the final product is 99.9% ethanol. So we are going to provide, produce the bioethanol with the help of this latest technology, that is extractive distillation technology, or the advanced technology also. That is PDC means pre-concentration distillation, and EDC that indicates the extractive distillation, and SRC indicates solvent recovery. So we are producing the ethanol or bioethanol with the help of advanced technology, and also going to recover the solvent with the help of this advanced technology. Second column or the diagram also indicates these technologies can be utilized in a single column also. So depending on our requirement, we can adopt the different technologies. Then dimethyl ether production. So we know what exactly the conventional process is. So in the dimethyl production, we know that that is the dehydration of methanol. So methanol is going to fade in the reactor and water is going to separate out. So the main reaction is CH3OH that gives CH3OCH3 and that gives the water. So dimethyl ether can be generated with the help of methanol with the help of dehydration process. That is the conventional process. But in this case, we can adopt the different technologies, that is the reactive DWC units, and we can have the higher efficiency with less energy consumptions. So from this Tarani diagram also, we can understand, we can have the good products with high quality and with the less energy requirement. So this is the diagram where we can adopt the DWC technique or RDWC technique instead of the conventional technique to produce the dimethyl ether from the methanol. So from this discussion, from this advanced technology or the technology, we can conclude that distillation is still young and full breakthrough opportunities. So still there are various parameters or the chances in the R&D, that is research and development. So there are some approaches should be adopted, and the main approach is the process intensification principles. So in the heat pumps also, we can understand, we can go for the HPAD techniques, especially for the temperatures having range 30 to 100 degrees Celsius, wherever it is possible, and that can save the 80% of our primary energy requirement. We can also adopt the membrane distillation technology, especially it is suitable for the brackish water or the water as a main product, and we can adopt the renewable energy sources, so which reduces the overall cost of this total technology, that is membrane distillation. Then we can also adopt the high-g distillation technology, where we can adopt the rotating pack bed technology, and there are a variety of pack bed technologies and rotating beds are also available. So due to the high energy efficiency, due to the overall separation efficiency, we can go for this high-g distillation technologies. We can also adopt these cyclic distillations, especially when we are not going to adopt the vacuum, then we can easily adopt this cyclic distillation. And we know that the overall efficiency or the Murphy efficiency is very high as compared to the conventional technology, so that we can adopt easily this cyclic distillation. And this DWC, especially it is having the lower investment and the operating cost, and that is why we can adopt this DWC technology also. So this DWC technology also have the extractive or azeotropic or reactive distillation. So combination of these extractive, azeotropic, reactive distillation with DWC can be very useful, and that is why we must research, we must think of all these technologies, whatever the technologies are available as a advanced technology in the distillations. So we have already talked about these reactive distillations, which having the benefits of lower investment operating cost, which have reduced plant footprint, and that is why we should think of all these types of technologies, which is called as distillation technology. Thank you. Thank you for patient listening.